You can make a semantic model using one of four different tools. You could use Power BI Desktop, where you create reports or semantic models and then publish them into the Power BI service. You could actually create your model in the Power BI service or in Fabric in certain experiences. Or you could also create your model in Visual Studio or Visual Studio Code. And of course, you could also use Tabular Editor, either with or without any of the other previous tools. So what we're going to do now is give you a brief overview of what it looks like when you make a semantic model in Power BI or in the Power BI service. So let's take a look at Power BI Desktop to start. So what we have here right now is our Power BI Desktop, and we have loaded no data, as you can see. So it's just an empty canvas. We have, of course, all of our toolbars here at the top. We can look at different things, for instance, looking at our data or our model. But if we click on that right now, we see we don't have any information. Our model view is empty, our data view is empty, because of course we don't have any data. So let's go ahead and get some data. We're going to select recent sources, and we're going to choose the Tabular Editor training database, which you can use for free to learn any data tool, including Tabular Editor, Power BI Desktop, or Fabric. Now, this database is free and available for anyone to use. It's a SQL database, and we encourage you to use it, for instance, in this training, or if you just want to create some portfolio projects for yourself. So what I'm going to do now is I will just select and we will connect to this database. I've already authenticated previously off camera. And what we're going to do is we are going to select the brands, maybe customers, products, and invoices. And we want to do some very simple analyses from here. Okay. And products. So we've selected the tables that we want to load into our semantic model from our SQL database. We could click load. And if we do that, then we have to choose between import or direct query models. If you don't know what this is, an import is going to make a copy of your data in Power BI, which is always going to be faster than direct query. Direct query connects live to the data source, which is useful if that data changes frequently. Now, direct query is always going to be slower, but it's also more expensive. So you should always choose import first if you can. There's going to be a third option that we don't see here in the Power BI service if you have Fabric, but we'll talk more about that in a moment. So we are now loading our data. And if it's a small amount of data, this would be done probably very quickly. We can see that we've already got our customers and brands information. The number's not going up anymore of the number of rows, but we've got a lot of invoices. And indeed, we have over 10 million invoice lines in this table. So we don't need all of that information. So let's filter to just a single year. We'll go ahead and start doing some data transformations. And this is something that you can do in Power BI Desktop. If you're creating your model in Power BI Desktop, you can also transform it in Power Query. Power Query has this user interface where you can make all kinds of different transformations, and it will automatically, if you open the advanced editor, translate these into code in the M language, which you can see here, and transformation steps, which you can see on the right-hand side. So if we wanted to, for instance, filter our invoices so that we're only looking at data from 2019, for instance, we could then apply a filter. So we could say, give me only the data between after, and then we select the date that we want. So say December 31st, 2018, and is before December 31st, 2019. I'll choose January 1st because it's after or equal to. And this should give us now our filtered data. So you see that it's automatically generated this information and it's added a new step where we've filtered the rows. So this is what we're doing. We're connecting to our data source and we're transforming that data so that it's in the shape that we need for our semantic model. We're going to go ahead and rename our tables as well. Invoices, customer, brand, and product. And then we can go ahead and load that information into Power BI. And since we're loading much less rows, it's going to be a lot quicker because we don't have to wait for all the data that we had previously loaded. So once we have all that information, we will be able to see it in the data view, and we can also start to create our semantic model in the model view of Power BI Desktop. So hopefully we're already almost there, and then we can proceed with those next steps. This is more or less the experience that you would expect when you're creating a model, an import model in Power BI Desktop. Of course, you could also do these data transformations upstream in another ETL tool, like Data Factory, Data Pipelines, or a notebook, for instance. So we've loaded our data. We have our brands, customer, and so on. And when we click through these tables, we can actually see the data that's in those tables. But again, remember, we want to create a model, right? Because we have our brands, but we want to analyze our invoice quantity by brand. So how do we get from brand to invoices? Well, for that, we have to go to our model and make some relationships. And we see that Power BI has already made some relationships for us. These are just the links between the tables. So if I collapse these tables, so each of these squares is one table, Power BI is actually showing us how it created these relationships. For instance, between subbrand with product and brand table, and the relationship with the product key to the invoices. Now the one here means that there's one product key in the product table, but there's many in the invoices table. So this is a one-to-many relationship, and that's what this is showing us. So this is already the start of our semantic model. This is what a semantic model looks like. We have our tables, those tables have columns with data, and we have some relationships linking those tables together. Of course, we might also want to create some calculations, like DAX, for example. So we can create a new measure, and we can call that measure total quantity, which will be the sum of our invoice quantity. And then we can test whether this measure actually works. So if we search it in our data pane, we can add it to our report, choose something that's more legible, like a card, and we can see that we have our total quantity here for invoices, but we could also now look at our brands if we wanted to analyze this by brand, change it to a table, and we can now look at our invoice quantity by brand. So this is more or less the process you go through when you're creating a semantic model in Power BI Desktop. Of course, there's many more steps than this, but this is just to give a very brief overview of what this looks like. Once you've created a semantic model, you then have to, of course, publish it. Because again, we want to use our semantic model to answer different kinds of questions. We're not just going to create one report with one model in this one file and then use that. We're going to create multiple reports. For instance, if I wanted to look at my customers and I wanted to break out the customers by different metrics with my invoices data, I could do that in the same report, but I likely want to do that in a different report. So in order to do that, I have to save my model in my download. So we'll call this new model. And then once we save the model, we can publish it to a workspace in Power BI or in Fabric. So we hit publish, and we can publish this now, and we'll publish this in, for example, the Contoso database. We'll go ahead and publish it there. And once it's published, we can now connect to that model. It's going from a local model on our machine to a remote model that is in the workspace. So it's the same thing as sending it to a server. Now it's going to be available and we can connect to it from any tool that supports that kind of connection. So we could connect to that model from Power BI, but we could also connect to it from Excel or Tabular Editor. So the model's finally published. And now if I open a new window for Power BI, so we'll wait for this to load. So now again, we have no information in here, but instead of creating a new semantic model, I could actually just go get data, Power BI semantic models, and then I could connect to that semantic model that I just published. I select connect. And now Power BI is going to make a live connection to that semantic model and is going to tell me in which workspace that model is. So I could start with creating, for example, my analysis by customer account. So if I wanted to look at the key account name, quantity, it works just the same way. And that's how we reuse our semantic models. So now we're connected to this remote model and we can create multiple reports that are connected to that remote model. This is, in a nutshell, what it looks like when you create a semantic model in Power BI. But what about in Fabric? In Fabric, now I have opened a workspace, and what I could actually do is I could create a semantic model in here as well. So if I go new semantic model, I could actually add my data in here and go through a similar process, but I could also create a direct lake model if I have Fabric and I'm in a lake house. So for instance, if I go into lake houses here, I could go to the lake house that I currently have open, and I could select new semantic model, and I could create a direct lake model. And I can then choose the tables that I want to add into that semantic model.